This is Information Service Engineering, lecture number 6, Knowledge Graphs. This is the very first part of the section Knowledge Graph of this lecture. And in this section, we are going to talk about knowledge representation and ontologies. But before we can talk about knowledge representations and how to represent knowledge, we first have to make clear what is knowledge. What is knowledge? Have you ever asked yourself what is knowledge? Have you tried to explain it to somebody? Let's try. And who is going to help us with that? It's philosophy. In philosophy, there are usually four major branches. So you have epistemology, metaphysics, ethics, and logic. And to define what knowledge is, epistemology will help us. So this is an epistemologic definition of logic. And it dates back to Plato in the 1st century BC. So, how can we define knowledge? What is out there in the world are the so-called set of truths. What is truth? Truth is the property or state of being in accordance with facts of reality. So, this is truth. What is out there? This is reality. Do we know all truths? Do we know everything about reality? Certainly not. Of course, we have a lot of things in our head. So what we have in our head and what we think of the world to be true, this is the set of our beliefs. So belief is one of the core concepts in epistemology. A belief is an attitude that a person holds regarding anything that they take to be true. So are all beliefs true? Certainly not. So as you see here, if we try to represent this with kind of set diagrams, we see that there is an intersection between what is really true and what are our beliefs. So we have here an interesting part of that area that are the true beliefs. Now we're coming closer to what is knowledge. Are the true beliefs already knowledge? The point is, do we really know which of our beliefs are really true? Probably we don't. And then, of course, only another fraction of exactly this intersection between beliefs and truths is really the part of the true beliefs that for us is justified to be true. So knowledge are justified true beliefs. And justification here again is a term that is used in epistemology. And a belief, they say, is justified if one has good reason for holding it, or so if one have proof, for example. And this is an epistemologic definition of logic. Okay, we can formalize this in a way with the help of course, now mathematical logic in the so-called tripartite analysis of logic. S, let's say this is an individual, knows that P is true if and only if P is really true. S believes that P is true. And S is justified in believing that P is true. Only then we can say P is part of our knowledge. Okay, so the traditional definition of knowledge is not knowledge is a justified subset of all true beliefs. And if we want to represent knowledge now with the help of a machine, what we need is a kind of formal knowledge representation and or ontology. But what is this? We are going to clarify soon. Okay. What we have in our hands to express ourselves and also to express knowledge is language. We know now already a bit of language since we had dealt with language in the first section of the lectures when we did natural language processing. So I will give you also a language example. Climate change is the Everest of all problems. What does it mean? I have to ask you. Of course, climate change is a major problem. Anyway, it will also be a major problem in the near future. If I give you a hint, what is meant by Everest, of course, we might think of Everest, of course, of the mountain. The Everest is the highest mountain of the Earth. So therefore, climate change, and this is then kind of a metaphor you see here, the meaning is deeply buried under several layers of abstraction and remapping. So this is a metaphor. Climate change is the biggest problem of all, since Everest is the tallest or the highest mountain we have. But it's difficult to get there, to really come to the point what is really meant by that phrase. Let's have a closer look on that process. So how does this kind of understanding really work? We extract here the text Everest, and of course Everest is an ambiguous term. We have also dealt with ambiguity so far. So what we have to find out, so for what exactly stands Everest here? We have many possibilities, and the process of mapping, you know, a text expression to a specific entity which has a unique meaning, this process is called entity mapping or entity disambiguation. So disambiguation is the solution of ambiguities. So what might it mean? Everest might be Everest, Kansas, which is a small village. It might also be the Everest gas field, which is a gas field near Scotland. And also it might refer to a person. So for example, to George Everest. Who was George Everest? He was Surveyor General of India and also the namesake for the Mount Everest. Of course, it can also be another person. Nobody of us probably knows Jack Everest, but he's a famous Irish football player. And of course, in the end, the Everest is Mount Everest. It's a mountain. But to find out, this is really difficult. And it's even more difficult if the words in the immediate surrounding don't necessarily tell you the story, so tell you exactly what it means. So disambiguation is the solution of ambiguities. And how does it work? By explicitly mapping ambiguous language expressions to unique knowledge representations. So we need knowledge representations for that to make clear what it really means. So if you see this here, just try to remember from the semiotic triangle that we have already talked about here, we have our symbols, and these symbols have to be mapped to unique concepts here. And this is the process of disambiguation. Of course, language is a knowledge representation. However, it's not a formal knowledge representation. So it lacks formal interpretation and it's full of ambiguity. Logic, on the other hand, so modern versions of logics are capable of representing any factual information that can be stated precisely in any language, natural or artificial. While natural languages display the widest range of knowledge that can be expressed, mathematical logic enables a precisely formulated subset of this to be expressed in a computable form. And this exactly is where we are going to go. So, what does it mean? How do we represent knowledge? We have again here our Everest as text, and we map it to an entity, to a unique concept, to the concept of Mount Everest. But now we have also to distinguish these kind of concepts. What is Mount Everest? We know Mount Everest is a mountain. So it's a particular mountain, a specific mountain. Mountain is something like, yeah, there are many mountains. Therefore, you distinguish among the concepts those which identify precisely one unique thing, like for example, the Mount Everest. And these kind of concepts are also called particulars or individuals. And on the other hand, you have these more general concepts, which can also be defined as a class, a mountain. If you think of a mountain, you don't think of a specific mountain. You think of any kind of mountain, and you think of anything or everything what mountains do have in common, for example. So therefore, mountain is a general concept, it's a universal concept, so it's also referred to as universal. And this is the first distinction that we learn. We have particulars on the one hand side, we have universals on the other hand side. And also among these universals, there might be, you know, kind of an ordering. We know that any kind of mountain is a special type of a landform. However, also a landform is also a special type of some geomorphic unit. And this kind of hierarchy that we have here among the concepts, that forms a so-called taxonomy, which means this is a hierarchy for classifying, categorizing things. This is already rather handy. So we can see here many things, so that Mount Everest is already a mountain, and we know that a mountain is a special type of a landform, and a landform is a special type of a geomorphic unit. But by doing this, we already know more. from, you know, what we know from our language. We know that if Mount Everest is a mountain and a mountain is a special type of a landform, we know also that Mount Everest is also a landform. And also Mount Everest thereby is a geomorphic unit, since landform is a special case of geomorphic unit. And this process that we can deduce, that we can infer this implicit knowledge, this is referred to as logical inference. And this is one of the powers that lies into knowledge representations. So also it means that if a mountain is a landform and a landform is a geomorphic unit, it also tells you that a mountain is thereby also a geomorphic unit. So this is really cool. The power of formal knowledge representations, what we refer to as ontologies, lies in automated inference mechanisms. We can automate this process and we can really use it. And this is really cool. So therefore, now we are going to define formal knowledge representations. So what are formal knowledge representations? First of all, this is kind of a field. Formal knowledge representation is the field of artificial intelligence, which unambiguously, so we have no ambiguity, captures the semantics, which means the meaning, of concepts, of properties, relationships, entities, of anything here, of specific knowledge domains, which means fields of interest or areas of concern, as structured data. So we bring the meaning to a level which is in the end structured data, and from that we have some interpretation mechanism that gives us a clue and also the rules how to deal with it, how to infer and deduce new knowledge with that. The point is that machines, in that case computers, must be able to understand these formal knowledge representations. And we know already, when we were talking about the art of understanding in natural language, to understand a knowledge representation means that the machine must be able to interpret it correctly, so to capture its meaning. So thereby, now everything we are doing will be with explicit semantics. Okay, and we have already talked about knowledge representation as ontologies. Now we are going to define what is an ontology. First of all, the notion ontology comes from philosophy, so it's much older. So it was already there when there were no computers or anything at all. And in philosophy, it denotes a branch of philosophy that studies concepts such as existence, being, becoming, and so on and so on. So ontology is a theory of being which tries to explain the being itself by developing a system of universal categories and their intrinsic relationships. So this includes question of how entities are grouped into basic categories and which of these entities exist on the most fundamental level. Sometimes also ontology is referred to as the science of being. It belongs to the major branch of philosophy known as metaphysics. We have already now heard of epistemology. So this was when we defined what is knowledge. And when we want to talk about the existence of, when we want to talk about the being in itself without, you know, shutting out everything like perception and things which are, you know, betraying us, then we are talking about ontology. So this is the most pure kind of philosophy, as they often say, within metaphysics. Okay, so ontology already, you know, is part of philosophy. If you now ask, where does the term come from? So the term, of course, is Greek. However, it first occurred in the times of the Renaissance. So the very first reference to the word ontology comes from 1606, in a Greek book called Octua Scholastica by Jacob Loerhard. And then in 1613, in the Lexicon Philosophicum by Rudolf Göckel, in Latin or Latinized, the name was Goclenius, and probably you have heard it if you are in philosophy. So this is from the 17th century. However, metaphysics is much older. So people are dealing with metaphysics since, you can say, the beginning of recorded history. So because everybody wants to talk about, you know, existence and being and want to find out why does it make sense? What's the reason for being and stuff like that? So therefore, this is a rather ancient branch of philosophy. However, In information science and computer science, we have adapted a bit of that and now are making use of ontology for formal knowledge representation. Thereby, in computer science, an ontology is nothing else but a so-called explicit formal specification of a shared conceptualization. This is a rather concise definition that we have to, of course, look a bit closer on it. However, so since the mid-1970s, researchers of AI have recognized that knowledge engineering is the key to building large and powerful AI systems. So they started to, let's say, create ontologies as computational models for automated reasoning. And in the 1980s, the AI community began to use them and began to use the term ontology to refer to both a theory of a modeled world as well as a component of a knowledge-based system. And the first time the term ontology really was used then there in artificial intelligence was in 1983 by David Powers. And we have here the definition, the rather concise definition of an ontology in computer science by Thomas Gruber from 1993. So it's adapted a bit, it's not literally taken. So let's have a look again at this definition. An ontology is an explicit formal specification of a shared conceptualization. What does it mean? What is a conceptualization? Okay, conceptualization is nothing else but an abstract model. An abstract model means we need some kind of domain of knowledge we are talking about, and there we have to identify what are the relevant concepts, what are the relevant relations. So this is our conceptualization of what we are going to represent. Second, it must be explicit. Explicit means the meaning, the semantics of all concepts must be defined. So it's of no use if we simply leave out stuff, because then we have a hole in our theory. This doesn't work. Third, it has to be formal. Formal means we have to use some kind of mathematical logic to make it machine understandable. Big difference here, please be careful. Not only machine readable, everything which can be, let's say, read by a parser like HTML is already machine readable. However, you have no idea what it really means. It has to be machine understandable in the sense that the machine then is able to interpret the meaning correctly. And of course, everybody who is using this ontology must have a shared consensus about the ontology. So it has to be shared. It's really, really important, because if I think something completely different of the model that somebody else has created, then most likely we will be using it in different ways. And let's say we will not have any intersection, or there might be then something wrong in the end. So we must reach consensus of what does this mean? What do we want to represent here? Then everything is fine. Okay, so an ontology is founded on a shared understanding of the domain terms. And the domain terms are objects, concepts, relations, and they should be interpreted in the same way by every user. Okay, so now let's talk about quickly how can we represent these kind of ontologies. We need already for the representation of ontologies an abstract model. So this is this conceptualization, which means it should contain something like classes, which are our universal things we are talking about. Classes can be described via attributes. And then, of course, if classes interact with each other, there are relations among the classes that have to be described. And then, of course, not all relations are possible, and we have to define what is a, let's say, useful or meaningful relation, and which kind of relations are allowed and which not. So these are then the constraints and restrictions. And of course, we also have to take care about our particulars about which we want to say something. These are the individuals in the classes of our ontology. And then, for example, we can put also procedural knowledge into these ontologies by defining rules like if-then-else rules. And we can define axioms, which means this is all the knowledge, all the statements, all the facts we want to represent about the domain that is under our consideration. So this is what we are going to need to represent an ontology. Let's start with the classes. Classes are abstract groups, sets or collections of objects, and they represent the ontology concepts or the universals. But we have to be careful. Not every universal is also a class. A class is something that can be instantiated, something where it makes sense that we can say something is member of the class, and there are individuals which are collected in a group which is the class. But this is something we might discuss later in the course, so the difference between classes and universals. These classes that we describe, classes, think of classes like set theory, they are characterized by attributes. Let's say a human has a specific height, has a specific weight, has a specific birth date. So these are attributes. And these attributes, they can be represented as name-value pairs. So take an example here. There are different, let's say, levels of formality when I define an ontology. I can say, for example, if I want to define what is an element, a chemical element, an element is a pure substance which cannot be broken down by chemical means, consisting of atoms which have identical numbers of protons and their atomic nuclei, and so on and so on. So this would be a description, an informal description of what is an element. Of course, this is not an ontology. This is a description in natural language. This is a rather informal description. You can go one step further. If you think of, like, in programming languages, if I want to define, let's say, a class element, then I can say, okay, so that the class has the following attributes. It has a name, which should be a string. It has a chemical symbol, which should be a string. It has an atomic number, which should be an integer. It has an atomic weight, which should be a float, and so on and so on. But this is semi-formal. It will become fully formal if I really then try to define this with the help of mathematical logic. Then I have a fully formal description of that. Okay, you see here again the attributes, and you see here the attributes are consisting of name and value pairs, and here in the class description we have here the name of the attribute. Last one could look at that, it's melting point, and then we have a value type, which is then float, not the value itself, but the type of the value, which is given here in angle brackets. Okay, besides the classes, we have to take care about relations. Classes can be related to other classes with a kind of relations, which are special attributes whose values are objects of other classes. So you have here a nice interesting class diagram which shows lots of relations between classes. We have here, for example, a class which is air pollutant. And we have here other things like, for example, lung cancer. Lung cancer might have one of the causes is air pollution, and one of the causes of air pollution is lung cancer. On the one of the causes of air pollution is an air pollutant. Sorry about that. Okay, and air pollutant might be a superclass of, for example, a radioactive air pollutant or of a greenhouse gas, which means greenhouse gas and radioactive air pollutant, they are connected to air pollutant via a subclass identifier. On the other hand, both of them might be the main subject of a scientific article, which also has a cause, which is academic writing. So thereby, by these relations among classes, I try to define an entire domain. What are the main concepts and how do they relate with each other? If I want to go a step further, I define now exactly rules and constraints which hold for attributes and for relations, you know, that determine what kind of values are allowed, which kind of connections are allowed. I could say, of course, that a specific disease has as a cause air pollution, but there might be many diseases which are caused by air pollution, and of course diseases might have many other causes besides of air pollution. So this is an N-to-M relation and an N-to-M constraint here. On the other hand, smog is a subclass of air pollution, and this might be a one-to-one relation. Like, for example, also air pollution has as cause, besides others, a car, and this might be an one-to-n relation. Of course, you can also model it in a different way, and we also have to keep in mind models are only a specific view of the reality. They are not the reality, because according to the purpose or your intention, what you're going to do with the model, of course you leave out parts of reality that you don't have to model to fulfill in the end your purpose. So therefore, models are only a small part, or you know, a small view of reality. And I neglect many things that are not important for me. So it's not reality, it's only a model. Another thing what I can model here, for example, is we have another cause for air pollution, which might be a volcanic eruption. And we know that if we now look at these two causes of air pollution, car and volcanic eruption, usually no individual is at the same time in both of these classes. So a car is not a volcanic eruption, and a volcanic eruption usually is not a car, which means both classes are disjunct. And this, of course, is a constraint. What's missing are then the instances. So you see here in the blue part of our small knowledge base that we have created, we have here the instances, and instances describe individuals or the individual objects of an ontology. And I can, for example, define carbon dioxide to be a greenhouse gas. Carbon dioxide has a name and also has a chemical formula. And a greenhouse gas, for example, is a subclass of air pollutant and might be the subject of a scientific article. And usually what you are referring to, so the part of your ontology which is concerned with the classes, so with the more universal part of the ontology and the relations among the classes, this is the so-called terminological knowledge. And the other part, which is then really focused on the particulars, which means the individuals and the individual facts that you see in your ontology, this is the assertional knowledge part. And these two parts, terminological knowledge and assertional knowledge, for short, are also referred to as T-box, terminological knowledge, and A-box, assertional knowledge. Last thing, what you see here are the axioms. So here you see, for example, that carbon dioxide has the chemical formula CO2. So this is an axiom. An axiom are assertions that together comprise all or the overall theory that the ontology describes in its domain of application. So everything you see there are axioms. Now, we see that we can represent ontologies with kind of a conceptual model, with an abstract model. However, how does the computer now understand this conceptual model? The point is, we can't share knowledge if we don't speak a common language. So this means, again, we need a language for representing exactly these kind of ontologies. And as I already told you, what we are referring to here is on the grounds of mathematical logic, therefore it's understandable for machines. And thereby, in the next section of the lecture, we are going to talk about the efforts of the semantic web and the web of data towards machine understandability.